In November 1950, the Korean War had just broken out. The Cold War was really getting worse and more dangerous, and there was this feeling that Russia was breathing down our neck and they might invade Western Europe. So my parents said, better leave. Go east, young man, go east, which is what I did. So by air, I flew to Haneda. Yes, Haneda Airport was there, but the terminal building was only a wooden shack, but it was really a small building. The cityscape, the townscape between the airport and the center of Tokyo was still as if it was a war zone, except that the rubble had been cleared, but there were lots of empty spaces everywhere. Once there was this feeling, yes, we've got to rebuild this country, everybody got busy, and it was not a matter of getting the best deal or getting a high salary. It was a matter of dedicating yourself to the rebuilding of the country. I think that was what we all felt at the time. That was very inspiring.
When I came to Japan, foreigners were very few. When you walked down the street, you were Exhibit A, and even mothers would grab their kids and point at you. Look, it's a foreigner. Sometimes I went home and I looked in the mirror to see if I wasn't purple with green spots or something like that, because but there were no expectations.
At that time, the people in Japan were not very used to foreign people. There were hardly any people of this complexion. So very often, when I was walking on the streets with my present wife, who at that time was my girlfriend, they used to ask her, why are you walking with a black man, a kurombo? Oh, that was many, many times, but I didn't feel so bad about it, because actually there were very few people of this complexion at that time, and so they were not used to it.
They also were putting up traffic signs in English in the center of Tokyo. They were not translations, but just when it says Aoyamadori in Japanese, they would add also the English text Aoyamadori in Roman characters. That happened all over. That was unusual in Japan.
I think in those days there was a lot of curiosity about foreigners. And I remember people coming and after when we were at home and ringing our doorbell and asking if they could English us. They wanted to come and practice their English. And I remember my older of my two boys had a friend who worked at a noodle shop down the street. And the man would come and get him and put him on the back of his bicycle, and they would go to a pachinko parlor. Now, my son was very good at selecting the machine and the buttons to push. And so the guy always took my son along and came back with a lot of pachinko balls in his pocket.
The 1964 Olympics were awarded to Japan, to Tokyo, 5 years before the date. That really unleashed such a feeling of hope and pride and determination to make it a success. It really uplifted life in Japan, and we could all feel that, you know, living here.
Buildings were coming up, roads were being built, and even the people, they were all excited. Oh, the Olympic Games, the Tokyo Olympic Games are coming. And gradually, the people began to take an interest in the foreigners coming into Japan. And even my complexion seemed to have been forgotten.
The reason the Japanese took over the accepted to do the Olympics was because they wanted the to show how all the improvements they had made since the war.
Aoyama Dori in between Akasaka and Roppongi, that was a major road, famous road, but it was too narrow. So they demolished all the houses on one side, widened them, and that way it became a real good avenue. There was the feeling I have and the memory I have is of enthusiasm, of dedication, of excitement. It's not so much in specific incidents, you know, except a couple of things I just mentioned, but it was more the mood, and that was what I think represented the mood of the time, and it also helped, I think, making the Olympics in Tokyo such a success. It was a great success. By this announcement that Tokyo would be the Olympic city in 5 years' time, that continued, and it really re-energized Japan. And there was a feeling that Japan was finally again, you know, becoming a nation that was recognized by the world and no longer defeated as it was for so long after the war.
The Olympics were such a big thing, and I think most Japanese bought TVs during that time so that they could enjoy the Olympics. I think that must have been made the biggest sale. I was fortunate because my husband had tickets that I could go to some of the programs, and they were absolutely spectacular. I had never had a TV. I'd never seen things on TV. So watching all the people at the opening ceremony coming in, marching in with their country's flags, and guy running in with a torch and going up and lighting the torch on the top of the stadium. Those are very good highlights of the Olympic Games.
People in Japan were not rooting only for their countrymen, but even for others who did well. For instance, the 800 meter race had a Sri Lankan who finished two laps behind the winner, but he got a standing ovation. So the people in Japan were becoming more international, I thought.
One of the Olympic sports that had been added, or maybe the only sport that had not been previously an Olympic sport, but was added for the Tokyo Olympic, was judo. So Japan, being the host, they said, we want to have judo. And judo was also being practiced in many other countries, but it never became an Olympic sport until then. Guess what? The gold medal for judo went to a Dutchman. Japan thought this was at least that would be the sport where they would gather all the medals.
At the end of the Olympics, they had put together a movie. And because my husband was on the organizing committee, we hadn't been invited. It was down in the cushy area to watch the movie of the Olympics. It was a very good, very well put together movie of all the different events and things like that and things behind the scenes. It was a wonderful movie that we were invited to. I would hope that this 2020 gives Tokyo a chance, or Japan, a chance to look back to see where they have come from and where they're going. I'm pretty hopeful that even if we look back at the last Olympics and how much progress has been made in those years, that we can see that we're moving ahead. And moving ahead is not getting rid of all the old stuff.
Most Japanese are looking forward to a new Japan with the 2020 Olympics. And this time, they want to make Japan number one again. So I hope I can live until the 2020 Olympics, at least.
Good morning, Wicky-san.